On the eve of Rosh Hashanah, my son was born. And a short while later, a few weeks later, I carried out an assignment to go to the United States and strengthen our delegation in security and Haganah affairs. I arrived there maybe a week before the United Nations decided on the creation of a Jewish state. That was a decision taken on the 29th of November. It's for us a historical date, and so I remember it exactly. We had to prepare ourselves to take over. The activities were varied. There were open activities and clandestine activities. The clandestine activities were purchasing boats, which would be rebuilt to accept a much greater number of people living for the few days of the journey between somewhere in the voyage, between somewhere in Europe and the coast of Palestine. We also tried to get in a small way arms. A small way meant that we went to individuals, or we encouraged individuals who had taken a pistol and sometimes a submachine gun home as a souvenir at the end of the war, to give it to us, and we tried to ship these things to Israel. These were always small consignments. They were comparatively easy to ship straight through the mail, designed as something else. But this is not how you furbish an army. We were under such difficult circumstances that an individual pistol and an individual submachine gun also meant a great deal. But we were dreaming all the time about major army supplies. We had established an office in New York in a little hotel called Hotel 14. It was on 14 East 60th Street. In this Hotel 14, there was downstairs in the cellar a great nightclub called the Copacabana. We never had time to go to the nightclub. We only heard the noise from the nightclub. But one day we were in a difficult situation. There had been some arms collected and brought to the waterfront and loaded on a ship. And in the waterfront, we had a great deal of help. You asked about the mafia before. The mafia took care to persuade the harbor people to let these cases of ours loaded freely without any customs or police investigation on certain boats. Now, the equipment was on that particular boat, but the captain was not going to leave until he got a fairly major amount of money as advance. The rest he would get on delivery in Israel. We had to get this money to him. We were all the time, the two or three of us who worked here all the time, observed by the FBI. When I was going down to the harbor, to the pier, and going to the captain and giving him the money, it couldn't have been done without being detected, without being followed, and the whole enterprise was in danger. At Copacabana, you had various artists' function, and one of them was a man who since then has become famous, and although he is today not a youngster anymore, makes everybody excited when he appears on the stage, and that was Frank Sinatra. In between acts, I approached Frank Sinatra, told him my story, and asked him to take a briefcase with money down to the pier and give it to the captain. And he was a man full of spunk and full of ideas and full of willingness to do dangerous things, as he is until today in many ways. And we became great friends afterwards. And this is in Rome. They took the seven stick candelabra, which was of gold, to Rome for a victory march. And this is a copy of what is shown on the Arc of Titus in Rome. And here on the other side, you see the beginnings of Christianity, of which you will see a great deal more in some of the other rooms. This is the Church of St. Anne's. It's a very beautiful architectural, very beautiful building. And it went from hand to hand at various periods. Now the Muslim sheikhs are moving out. You see, and the nuns are moving in. And you see the cross. I came back at the beginning of May in 48. And the thing that then was most difficult to obtain was a ticket to get into the museum, the then museum on Rothschild Boulevard in Tel Aviv, where the people who had been meanwhile working as a temporary government, gradually preparing themselves, were meeting under the chairmanship of Mr. Ben-Gurion, declaring the State of Israel. I got this great advantage, and I don't know of any other person who had been both at the decision at the United Nations and counting the votes there privately, and at the declaration. So this is, for me, a very interesting memory of these two different positions. The same evening, a little later, the first Egyptian planes came over Tel Aviv and bombed Tel Aviv. The Arabs attacked us from all sides. We lost in this war 6,000 to 7,000 young people. But we won. We established a Jewish state. We threw back all the Arab armies. I went back to the United States in 51. After we had decided to start the bond issue. That was additional capital. We had absorbed twice as many immigrants as we had Jewish inhabitants in Israel. There were about 600,000 Jews here when the state was started. And we absorbed during the first 2 years 1.2 million immigrants. Even today, you see here in Jerusalem how immigrants from Russians to Ethiopians are accepted in the clear knowledge that this is our task, because it makes life for us easier or more difficult, is of no consequence. Those are Jews on the run in difficult situations. We are here to absorb them. And this was the first humanitarian task, Zionist task, political task, more important than all the political speeches, to have these Jews here in Israel and settle here. With all the efforts of the United Jewish Appeal and of other Jewish appeals in America and England or so, this was not the kind of money that could cover this need. So it was decided to have a bond issue of the State of Israel. We prepared all this, and we prepared Mr. Ben-Gurion's visit to 10 cities to start the bond sale in every one of those cities. We were received in every city with the greatest of enthusiasm. But on the way, we did something else, which was one of the exciting events in my life. We took Mr. Ben-Gurion via Princeton, and in Princeton he visited Einstein. This hour was Einstein centered around the idea, was there a superior being? Was there some kind of superior power? Not necessarily the individual God who helps you when you are in trouble, to whom many people pray. But was there some unifying idea to the universe? But this was an hour of particular flavor. I don't remember any other in my life of that kind, and I don't think many people have such an experience at all. I had a desire to catch up with a little bit of reading and knowledge and wanted to go for a year to Harvard. When I was phoned by Mr. Ben-Gurion and asked to come and run his office. And I finally came back and organized the Prime Minister's office. He was a comparatively easy person to work with. In all the matters that I dealt with, he didn't ever mix in. He was interested in foreign affairs, he was interested in education, he was of course interested in defense. With defense I had nothing to do. With other things I had something to do. It was for me to decide what I would bring to him and what not.
That was a short time after our War of Independence. Hundreds of thousands of immigrants came in from German concentration camps and from many other places. We needed technical aid and economic assistance badly. The United States offered it to us, as you call it, in diplomatic parlance, without strings attached. Now, 10 years after, looking back, we certainly have no regrets.
You see, this is showing the Muslim part. At the beginning, during the first 60, 70 years after Muhammad, Muslims turned to Jerusalem to pray. And here you have a mihrab and a prayer niche that comes from a little later, when they decided to turn to Mecca and not anymore to Jerusalem. No tourist office existed. So I started a tourist office, which we ran from the Prime Minister's office. This started working out. I found out that we would never get good art as a gift or so if we wouldn't build a good museum, a proper place where to hang them, a proper place where to guard them. I collected a few people who were connected with art and with archaeology, and in the end, in 65, we opened the museum. We had no idea how to run a museum, what to do with the museum. We had the great luck that a great museum director from Holland, who had also been a hero of the underground, Willem Sandberg, was willing to work with us for a couple of years. He trained the first curators, he set the standards, and today we have a museum which first of all has 1 million visitors a year. Many people come here only in order to see the Dead Sea Scrolls that they can't see anywhere else in the world. Many people come here to see the best collection in the world today of Jewish ceremonial art. And it has become a great institution for everybody. I regard myself much more as an administrator. So while I didn't have any great expectations of being elected, I felt my role as a candidate for the mayoralty was a more natural one than if I would have been number so-and-so on the Knesset list. So I stood for the mayoralty. And I didn't expect to be elected. To my great astonishment, I was elected, and here I was, and I became mayor, and I stuck to it for 28 years until I was defeated in 1993. Well, the most important thing is not the 28 years, but that we had a wall here, and all this was beyond in Jordanian territory. And up on that roof there of this building, which is a school, you had an Arab army post, and they shot at us. And you can see the shot marks if you look here at this wall. Until the 1st of December, I never entered City Hall. On the 1st of December in the afternoon, there was a little ceremony there where the former mayor would hand me over his chair or whatever it was. At that time, an old friend of ours, Chagall, was in the country, and he was sitting in the afternoon here on the back of this sofa. We were talking, and I invited him to come with me, and he refused. He said, "I'll stay here until you come back." When I came home, Mr. Chagall, he found somewhere the colored pencils of my children, and he put into the Chagall books illustrations like this, you see. This is not part of the book. This is part of his edition. And that was, of course, something that consoled me greatly at the time when I wasn't very happy about the mayoralty. It was the poorest possible city. Well, it was, of course, a divided city. Great parts of the city you couldn't visit because people shot from the other side. It was also a fairly neglected city. There were no trees or parks in public spaces. My main thoughts were, how will I stand these 4 years of mayoralty in order to get out? Then came suddenly the war in 1967. The army had given instructions that Jerusalem should neither be bombed from the air nor attacked with artillery. We were afraid for the holy places, like the Holy Sepulchre or the great mosques, that they might be hit and that would be damaged forever. We were not so much afraid for holy Jewish places. First of all, there are no holy Jewish places. The city is holy to the Jews, not individual places. And we lost 180 young people out of our desire to protect Christian and Muslim holy places. All over the city there was damage and many problems. And I ran from one problem to the other, taking care of children, taking care of elderly people. All the men were in the army. In the shelters, there were only women and elderly men. This was my task. I became a mayor of a complete city, but a very difficult city. Here everybody comes to pray, some in the mystical belief that their prayers will deliver them, and they put little pieces of paper into the crevices of the wall. But to me there is also the memory of having this plaza cleaned of little adobe huts which were belonging to an Algerian foundation where 106 Arab families lived, and we took this over. So we offered the people who lived there that we would pay rent for them somewhere else for 5 years instead of here, because here the rent was very low. And this was the only place in the entire city where we destroyed something that the Arabs built. I immediately realized what attraction this would be. that on holy days like Yom Kippur, and on the day of the destruction, of the day of atonement, and the day of destruction of the temple, Tisha B'Av, there would be tens and tens of thousands. In fact, hundreds of thousands came. Well, anybody can come here, and it is true, the religious Jews show a greater affection and less economic needs than the others do. I accept their religion and I even regard it highly. It is a thing that has to be regarded highly, their devotion. But if it goes on like this, in 40 years you will have a religious majority in Jerusalem. That wouldn't disturb me at all. What disturbs me is that they are intolerant. I don't want them to dictate to me or others like me how I should live. And that freedom we have to preserve.
Afterwards?
Not only for us, but also for the Muslims and the Christians. The city and we will be judged all over the world how we treat minorities. And Jews are minorities all over the world, and if we demand that they be decently treated, we have to treat minorities here in the best of fashion. There was an Arab town council. We went to them and suggested to them that they should join our town council in toto as a group and with equal responsibilities and with equal rights. They refused that. They didn't recognize Israel at all, certainly not the reunification of the city, and that was that. All our attempt of persuasion didn't help. We had afterwards years of reconstruction. The old city was in a terrible situation. It had no sewage, no drainage. Only 10% of the people had water at home. The others had to go to the well. If you take into account that we built a great clinic, which today deals with 900 patients a day, a library, instead of the little library they had in a rented room, a big new library. All this partly done by the Jerusalem Foundation. But the Jerusalem Foundation didn't get money from rich Arabs. It got it only from Jews who said they wanted to help, but they were very selective over what they wanted to help. I don't think that the Arabs were getting less than they should have. Here you have the first film made in Jerusalem about 100 years ago. You see various visitors to come to Jerusalem. Now we come to the British Mandate. And all this was